I'm Daniel Hicks, an economist here at the University of Oklahoma. Today, I'll discuss some of the major policy options for managing climate change that we as a society have available to us. Broadly, energy policy addresses how governments, corporations, organizations, or individuals produce, distribute, and consume energy. Examples include international treaties that limit where oil can be drilled and offshore deposits, domestic legislation to reduce fossil fuel emissions from cars and power plants, and state incentives to purchase energy-saving devices for your home. In this video, I'll focus on energy policies that pertain to the burning of fossil fuels, a major contributor to climate change. Generally, strategies for addressing climate change can be classified into two categories, mitigation and adaptation. Mitigation refers to reducing the intensity or source of something undesirable. For example, if water managers know a major rainfall event is coming, they could release water from a reservoir more slowly or over a longer period of time to lessen the impact. In the case of climate change, mitigation refers to decreasing the amount of greenhouse gases that we emit so that the changes to our climate are not as drastic. Adaptation strategies refer to policy design to manage the risk of or vulnerability to something undesirable. For example, you may adapt to living in a tornado-prone area by building your house out of stone instead of wood. Climate change adaptation focuses on coping with anticipated changes to Earth's climate by improving resilience and minimizing adverse impacts. I'm going to discuss policy choices that represent mitigation, while other videos in this series will deal with adaptation strategies. To reduce or stabilize greenhouse gas concentrations, we can either curtail the sources of these gases or enhance the sinks that remove these gases from the atmosphere. Examples of policies that would curtail the sources include higher fuel efficiency standards for vehicles, incentives for consumers to switch to solar and wind energy for their homes, and construction standards that promote the use of green building techniques to reduce energy needs. At the other end of the spectrum, policies that enhance the sinks include creating incentives to develop carbon capture technologies, promoting land management practices that enhance rangelands for carbon sequestration, and the REDD+ program, which is an international effort to reduce emissions from deforestation and forest degradation. Economists and policymakers have worked together to propose various ways to incentivize individuals, governments, and even corporations to adopt these behaviors. Two large-scale methods that you may have heard debated in the news are for a carbon tax and a cap-and-trade system. Typically, the price paid for things that we buy should be large enough to compensate producers for their production costs and provide some amount of profit. If profits are too high, more producers enter the market and push down prices. But market mechanisms sometimes fail. One very prominent market failure occurs when the good or service produced creates a cost that someone other than the producer or the consumer pays, something an economist calls an externality. Pollution, such as mercury runoff from a coal plant or tailpipe emissions, is a classic example of an externality. The price we pay for energy or for our cars is lower than the overall cost to society. Both the carbon tax and the cap and trade system try to correct this market failure by incorporating additional damages that greenhouse gas emissions cause to society into the price of the good or service. These policies then reduce demand and generate smaller externalities. They also generate revenues that can be used to mitigate the costs. A carbon tax is a pollution tax levied on emitters of greenhouse gases based on the carbon content of their commodity. It places a direct price tag on CO2 pollution, forcing all of us to face the social cost of the emissions. But for a carbon tax to succeed, the taxation rate needs to accurately equate to the size of the externality. If the tax is too low, then emitters have little reason to change their behavior. If the tax is too high, then it can shut down desirable markets or cause producers to hide their pollution, or move production to so-called pollution havens where taxes are lower. A cap-and-trade system works by creating a limit, or cap, on the total amount of greenhouse gases allowed to be emitted by all producers in society. In this system, an initial number of pollution allowances or permits is allocated to each producer. For example, if the U.S. wanted to reduce its total annual emissions from 5 to 4 billion metric tons, it could allocate 4 billion one-ton allowances across the market segments that produce emissions. A carbon market is then created for these allowances, where producers who over-emit can buy additional allowances from producers who are able to more easily reduce their emissions. The key advantage here is that producers who can reduce pollution most easily will do so. and can sell their permits to others who are not able to reduce emissions so quickly or easily. Cap and trade can also provide a controlled pathway for reducing total greenhouse gas emissions because the cap can be slowly reduced over time. As with a tax, careful thought must be put into selecting and allocating the initial allowances to incentivize emission reductions. Some cap-and-trade programs include options for carbon emitters to invest in offsets, which allow them to pay for emission reductions elsewhere in the world. Critics of cap-and-trade are quick to point out that regulating offsets creates incentives to corruptly game the system. For example, some countries have been found to develop carbon sources solely to later claim that they are reducing them by selling offsets overseas. In addition, offsets that take the form of sinks, such as averted deforestation, are sometimes problematic because they rely on maintaining consistent policies. Stated differently, current politicians cannot bind the behavior of future generations, so promises to preserve the rainforest today may be broken tomorrow. Regardless of whether you support a carbon tax or a cap-and-trade system, concentrations of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere are rising. Global action must be taken if there are to be significant strides in reducing concentration levels, because growing emissions from one nation can easily outstrip reductions from another. Determining the policy option that results in the greatest benefit for all can be a complicated endeavor, but policymakers know the economic tools available to them, and both of these systems have been shown to be successful when implemented properly.